It's Checking In with Anthony and Glenn, teaching you to be the hotelier that you wanna be. It's Checking In with Anthony and Glenn.
Anthony!
Glenn, we always start the show with you going, Anthony! And I always go, hey Glenn, what's going on?
That's right.
Let's start the show differently. Hey Glenn, how you doing?
You know what? I got to tell you, for the first time in a couple weeks, I am feeling good. I'm feeling happy. Maybe I've just had too much coffee.
See, but we always start the show that way. So let's come up with another start to the show. Ready?
Right.
And Glenn.
All right. Hey, how you doing?
How you doing? What's going on? How you doing?
Hey,
all right.
You know, checking in with Anthony and Glenn over here.
Yeah, you still want to do this friggin' show?
You know what, Anthony? I do want to do the show because I got to tell you...
I like
hanging out, hanging out with you and getting to do these shows is really like the highlight of my week.
Yeah, I just told you a secret off camera.
You did.
Or off microphone.
I know.
You want to tell the secret?
I do, but I would like to live to see the new year.
I was going to say, you want cement shoes? You want cement shoes?
I know. Look, man, I know you're from the neighborhood. I don't want to mess with that kind of stuff. So, you know, to the death, these secrets got
to
go.
That's right. That's right. It's true. It's absolute to the death.
What is that, Omerta?
I was talking to my friend Carla. She's my 2 a.m. I'm her 2 a.m. So
right.
At 2 a.m. in the morning, I got to get bailed out of jail. I call her and vice versa. And I literally said this. I said, you know, if you have a dead body that you need me to bury somewhere, I'm going to do it. And I mean it. It's
right.
Just the way I grew up. It's like, so anybody out there that needs a dead body hidden, call Glenn.
Right. Exactly. I'm here. I'm here to help. You know, dial.
Wait, the difference between a Jewish guy and a Italian guy, you call me up and say, hey, Anthony, just whack somebody. I need your help. I call you. I say, all right, give me 10 minutes. I'll be right there. I call you up and say, hey, I need help bury the dead body. What do you say?
I said I can't help you. I said, do you know who you're calling? If you need a good restaurant recommendation, call me. If you want to bury a corpse, I'm not your guy.
All right, so what are we talking about today, guys?
All right, so I before we get into it, I did want to say, you know, we're here recording once again our home away from home, the wonderful Garden City Hotel, and I did want to say that if you've got no plans for New Year's Eve, come down here to the Garden City Hotel.
Do you know what pisses me off about this hotel?
What?
That they have these unbelievable little, candies
that's
that they
right.
put on the table. And I'm wanting to eat them because they're so good, but I can't because I'm on microphone. So why are they in front of me if I can't eat them? That's not fair.
Really good point. Damn them and their amazing hospitality. How disgusting. And if you want to be infuriated by great hospitality, again, New Year's Eve here at the Garden City Hotel is going to be absolutely amazing. It goes from 9:30 to 1:30 a.m. with 4 hours of drinks, great buffet. Of course, it's got David Burke's top carving stations, a pasta bar, and more, plus DJ music. Champagne toast at midnight, and what every one of us needs most is a hangover exit station. So check out Garden City Hotel for that. Of course, there's a party attire here, and that's going to be, again, on December 31st, 9:30 p.m. to 1:30 a.m. But, Anthony, I got to tell you, I'm really upset. One of the things that I see is there seems to be a lack of understanding about where blame should be cast when it comes to the hotel business and certain things that are going wrong in the hotel business. And the first thing that I'm thinking about is Marriott's been dragged through the gutters here recently because of a data breach that happened before Marriott purchased Starwood, where more than 500 million guests' information was apparently stolen by the Chinese. So I'm curious as to you. What do you think about all
How do you know it's a Chinese? I didn't hear that. I didn't know about that.
While we were having breakfast this morning, above your head on the TV behind you, it said it looked like the hack was done by the Chinese. So I'm just kind of throwing
that
in without any real research.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Oh, so you're like somebody else that just takes all the information from CNN or Fox.
No. News 12 Long Island. And if they say it, it's got to be correct.
Hey, if the president can do it, you can do it.
Right.
Yeah. Why not? So, all right. So, this is my opinion. Okay. You were saying that Marriott is dragged through the mud.
Well, this happened before they even made the bid to acquire the company.
So what?
Well, it's not necessarily their responsibility.
Of course it is.
But they haven't been, they didn't do anything. It just came to light like last month and they said something immediately as soon as they found out about it.
They bought Starwood because Starwood's a good product. They bought Starwood because Starwood helps the Marriott brand. Mm-hmm. It makes the Marriott brand more attractive for many reasons. Mm-hmm. For their membership program, for their brands. They have some amazing brands. The Westin brand's my favorite brand, one of my favorite brands. So it helps Marriott because Marriott has a reputation as being kind of an old school kind of company.
Right.
So Starwood sex ups the brand. Sexy ups the brand. Mm-hmm. Correct?
Yep.
Okay. Whatever I just said. So they have good. Mm-hmm. Now they have bad.
Right.
So you take the good with the bad. So they absolutely own that problem. I don't feel bad for them. I don't think they're being dragged through the mud unfairly. They bought a company, and with the company comes all the good and all the bad. Now, was Marriott the responsible party at the time? Of course not. Marriott found the problem, and maybe it wouldn't have happened if Marriott owned it, but Marriott owns it, and that's the way it is. And now I'm sure there's going to be a lawsuit, and I'm sure there's going to be some responsibility. However, I don't feel bad for Marriott. I just now know that Marriott and their leadership is going to do a great job in making sure that that doesn't become the legacy of Marriott. So to me, it is what it is. It's not they're being dragged through the mud. It's like, oh shit, I bought a company, I got to deal with it.
Right, but you know, people like to vilify companies out there, even when they're not the ultimate evil thing out there, and that's the kind of issue that I really
So your leadership,
about. Right,
right, like Mr. Sorensen, who's an amazing leader,
got out in front of it,
sent out a letter, and I read the letter, and I was like, holy crap, I like this guy.
Yeah,
Marriott did a great job. You have a responsibility to have great leadership to be able to deal with crisis management. Now, I will respect Marriott even more for the way they handled it. We all know that breaching data is kind of the thing that we all have to worry about. We're all dealing with it. It just happened the other day. Like somebody spammed my email, and I can't get to any of my emails because there's 1,000 bullshit emails in front of it, and it's like I can't find the important emails. So we all know that's a problem.
Don't worry. I text you, Anthony. You don't have to worry about that.
So, but it's all – we all know it's – a matter of fact, if you know me, you know texting is the only way to communicate with me. But anyway.
Right. Sometimes I'll email you, and you'll just text me back with a response.
Yeah, I don't like emailing.
And I can't stand texting. So we're match made in heaven.
So my point being is there's an opportunity for Marriott to show why they're one of the most important companies in business.
Right.
They're dealing with a data breach that's of epic proportions. Mm-hmm. And I don't think many people are holding them personally responsible for it outside of the media and a couple of lunatics that are you know, lunatic Marriott people mm-hmm. that maybe hold them accountable. However, it gives them an opportunity to recover and show what their company's made out of. So I don't feel, oh my God, they're being vilified. Whatever. Look at, you got nailed. You're a major company. You have major leadership. You know, the chairman, the CEO of Marriott is one of the best leaders in business, and he got in front of it, and I'm proud to see how they handled it.
Yeah, they really are handling it well, and I got to tell you, Arne Sorensen is a smart guy that really knows what he's doing, and he's just so slick. When I've worked with him on stage before at an event where I had, you know, I got to interview him as part of a panel, he's unflappable, and he really, no matter what you say, is one of those guys that will turn it to whatever point he wants to make in a very subtle way that the audience doesn't even realize what's happening, but infuriates me because I can't ever get the guy to tell me what I really wanted to know.
And that's what makes a great leader in that kind of environment. Now, that doesn't make a great leader when you're trying to run an entrepreneurial company,
right,
like when you're starting an Apple or Google or whatever.
Right.
And if he was starting Marriott from scratch, I think he'd be different. But in that role of, okay, this is who we are, this is Marriott, now you're representing the Marriott brand, the Marriott family, then you need to make sure you're not caught in a bullshit lie, or you're not making shit up, and you know what you're talking about. You can't talk off the cuff in those positions. And that's why I think they handled this data breach more so well. With that said, I think the more important question is, what I'm finding in all the things that I've read in all the Facebook posts on Marriott from all the clients is like, and even on the Facebook post I made on my Facebook page about it,
right,
people's like, hey, it's just the world we live in. We got to deal with it. It's like, really? Is that what happened? That this is like gotten so bad that we're just kind of dealing with it? And we're like, listen, this is just part. You put your credit card online, you put your name online, and this is what's going to happen. You're just going to have to deal with it.
Well, the credit card companies have just said, screw it. We're just going to deal with it. They don't even, they just absorb all of the losses.
But people, where it's like, I was really, really surprised on my comments on Facebook when I said, what are your thoughts? And people were like, hey, it's just part of doing business. They're not going to lose customers. Marriott and Starwood are not going to lose customers.
I think that we're in such a cycle now with this intense news that comes out every single day that no matter how much you hate something or a company or are pissed off, within 24 hours, something else is going to come that's going to outrage.
24 hours? You mean like 24 seconds?
Yeah, and you're just going to move on to the next thing. There's very few companies, I think, that are out there that are in real danger when they make missteps anymore. 20 years ago, it was a completely different kind of a story.
Look, the NFL, right? The NFL handled concussions horribly. The NFL has handled abuse horribly. They were ran through the mud for many, many years. And now there's a lot of people that are walking away from the NFL. There's a lot of people not watching it as much. Now, I don't think the NFL is going away anytime soon, and I still love watching football. But those two areas, listen, you punch a woman in the face, you're fired. End of story. Like, what the fuck? Is that dragged out over 6 months? I need a video. Like, you, like, basically admit that you hit your girlfriend and that you're still working here? It's like, what other company could you, like, basically admit you beat the shit out of somebody, especially female, and still have a job?
Right.
I mean, and don't even get me started. I don't even bring it up.
I know.
I don't even
bring
it up. No. It'll go down a whole different...
Let me say then this. It's interesting you should say that about the NFL, because we had the XFL a number of years ago that was started by the WWE's Jim McMahon. Is that Jim McMahon?
Not Jim. Yeah.
Definitely McMahon. Yeah, I can't McMahon, believe I'm forgetting it. Jim McMahon, I think, was a football player. So anyway, I was going to say Ed McMahon, but that's definitely wrong.
Here's Johnny.
Yeah. So they're bringing back the XFL in 2020.
They are?
I recently found out. Yes. They've got 8 teams all set to go already. And one of the things that they're going to do.
Vince McMahon.
Vince, right. Vince McMahon. One of the things that they're going to do is make sure that they don't have any criminals that are in the league. And they're also going to keep protesting out of the league as well.
Okay, I like that.
I like that, too, because, you know, all
with
of
With that said, because I don't want any bad karma here, any bad emails, I believe that you are entitled to your First Amendment right, whether you work for a company or you don't work for a company.
Right.
And I think if somebody wants to kneel, they're allowed to. Do I like it? No, this is what I say. I was in the military. I will go to war for your right kneel.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I will go to war for you. But I probably wouldn't be your friend.
Right.
Right? That doesn't mean I don't respect you. That doesn't mean I don't like you. But I'm going, not that I wouldn't be your friend, but I don't know if I would agree with you. And I don't know if you and I should have a conversation about it because it could make me angry. With that said, you have every friggin' right to do that, in my opinion. But that's a whole different conversation.
Yeah, but it is a different conversation, but an interesting conversation nonetheless. And the way I came down on the kneeling issue is, yes, it's your right, but for me, personally, I think it's a disrespectful thing to do to your employer if you're doing it on the football field as a professional NFL player, because they are paying you to do a job and you're creating a distraction from that job that puts the person who's employing you in a bad position.
I agree with you.
If you protest on Wednesday, good for you.
I agree with you. But legally allowed to do it? Yes.
Yes.
Unless it's against their rules, which it wasn't. So from the constitutional standpoint, legally allowed to do it?
Agreed.
Yes. So I will stand up and I will fight for his right to do it. I will fight for his right to protest. And I think that if he's allowed back into the NFL, then he should be able to protest again. So I give him a lot of respect. And it took a lot of balls to do that.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I mean, Colin Kaepernick really put his money where his mouth
right.
was.
Right. So I have a lot of respect for him. With that said, do I like it? No. Do I think that he should abide by the NFL rules? Absolutely. But would I go on a battlefield and die for him for his right to do that? Mm-hmm. You're fucking right I would.
Right. Yeah, so it's interesting. I wonder if we're going to be called right-wing or left-wing loons for this part of the conversation.
You know what? I'm actually very close to like screwing it and just telling people how I feel about my political views.
Right.
But I think if I go there, I'll never come back.
It's just safer not to.
Right.
I would say. Okay. So I want to move on to another couple of great stories that we have here. But the first thing we need to do is hear a word from our sponsor. So stick around because we're going to be right back. Hey everybody, Glenn here. So listen to this. Cobblestone Hotels is celebrating their 10th anniversary, and man, have they accomplished a lot in the last decade. Already, they have more than 150 hotels throughout the United States, but they're in smaller and medium-sized markets. Those markets that the big franchise companies, they're underserving, they're overlooking, and in some cases, just ignoring. But Cobblestone is an expert in these markets. And their president and CEO, Brian Wagernese, listen, I've gotten to know him in the last 10 years, and he has worked every job possible, including being an owner and operator. I can personally vouch for how awesome this company is, how awesome he is as an individual, because he understands the importance of finding the right combination of hotel brand and franchise owner. He's also an incredibly dedicated professional. Whether it's a Cobblestone Hotel and Suites Main Street design, Borders Inn and Suites, or one of the newly acquired brands such as Boulders Inn and Suites, Key West Inns, Centerstone Inns and Suites, Cobblestone has brands that range from economy to upper mid-tier and one that's right for you. Quite simply, Cobblestone Hotels is the franchise for franchise owners. Patrick Mullenix, well, he's Cobblestone's new president of franchise development. Give him a call or check out their website at cobblestonefranchising.com. But give Patrick a call. He's a great guy. I've known him for a really, really long time, too. You can find him at 920-216-0620. That's cobblestonefranchising.com. And tell him Glenn sent you. Okay, and we are back. Anthony, you know, that was a fun conversation. I didn't expect to be talking about the NFL in a Marriott story, but it is interesting how people view brands and the things that happen and the perception that people have of them. Now, for example, there's another crazy story that's going on that happened this month. A woman has filed a $100 million lawsuit against Hilton Worldwide, claiming a hotel employee secretly recorded her while she was naked in the shower and then tried to blackmail her after posting the video to more than a dozen pornographic sites. She is a Chicago woman, but she was at a particular hotel in Albany, New York, where she was supposed to be taking the bar exam. And I was really surprised by this, but the hotel industry spin on it is, it's interesting to me that Hilton is being blamed when Hilton doesn't own that hotel. They're just a franchised property, right? Somebody owns it. Somebody manages it. Nobody from Hilton Corporate has anything to do with the day-to-day management of that property or the oversight of the property in that sort of way. So is Hilton responsible for something like this, or is it not? And if they are responsible for this, Anthony, then what kind of can of worms is that open for corporate responsibility for every single employee doing shitty things?
If I go into McDonald's and I bite into a Big Mac.
What about that coffee cup lady?
Right. The coffee cup lady, it was too hot, right?
Right.
Okay. Explain what you're talking about, then I'll answer the question.
Yeah, this has got to be 15, 20 years ago already. A woman at the drive-thru was given a cup of coffee. It spilled on her. She sued it for burning her. What people don't realize is how extensive the injuries were and how hot the coffee really was. And it wasn't just someone going, oops, I spilled some coffee, but she had skin grafts and it was a really serious mess. But it was the individual property, you know, the individual franchise McDonald's that did it, even though corporate
and
was
did she win money?
I think she won somewhere between a crap load and a shitload of money.
Right. Yeah. And from McDonald's.
Yeah.
Right. So, and now every single cup that says very hot on it at McDonald's because of that lawsuit.
It sure does. And they've lowered the temperature that they serve it at as well.
Correct. Mm-hmm. So everybody wins except McDonald's because they have to pay millions and millions of dollars.
That's
but
right.
At the end of the day, no one has to suffer, hopefully, what that woman suffered. So my answer is, she sued McDonald's and won because she went to McDonald's. She didn't go to
That's
John
right.
Smith's restaurant, who owns that restaurant. She went to McDonald's. So when I go to Marriott or Hilton, I go to a Hilton. I don't go to Glenn Houseman's hotel. I go to a Marriott or a Hilton.
It's the Smokehouse Resort and Pool Club, right. And you're welcome to come anytime between Memorial Day and Labor Day.
So are they legally responsible? Well, the court of law will tell you if they're legally responsible. But am I going to sue them if that happens to me?
Right.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Now, my lawyer, if it's a good lawyer, maybe I'll win, maybe right. I won't. It's just a part of doing business. That's why Marriott and Hilton have a lot of lawyers, and they spend a lot of money. They probably
sure
spend
do.
More money on lawyers than they spend on anything else.
Mm-hmm.
So that's just a part of doing business. And you can't say, we are Hilton, we are Marriott, we are the best, come to our hotels, come to our hotels, come to our hotels. You are training me that this is your hotel.
Right.
You're training me that McDonald's belongs to McDonald's corporate office. You are not saying, come to Marriott, and by the way, our partner, John Smith, is going to take good care of you.
Right.
So of course I'm going to sue because I chose your brand,
mm-hmm.
and your brand has an obligation to make sure I'm safe.
Right.
Right. Now, give you an example. When Erin Andrews won mm-hmm. somewhere between a shitload and a boatload of money,
right.
Okay.
Actually, I think that was between a shitload and a fuckload.
and she had the same incident happen to her, a little different, where someone was videotaping Erin Andrews, who's an anchor for the
ESPN,
NFL.
Right.
Or ESPN. And for other things. He was on Dancing with the Stars and all that stuff. And very famous person. And she was in a hotel room, and somebody videotaped her. And it
right.
was very traumatic. It was horrible. They put it on the internet. It was
they
just
videotaped
terrible.
Her through the door and the peephole.
And that's where you get it. That's where I'm going.
Yep.
So they videotaped her through the peephole. Do you know that I can still walk down a lot of hotels in this country and unscrew the peephole from the outside?
That's right. And the funny thing is—
So now everybody knows that. Every brand knows that you can unscrew these peepholes, and it's still a problem.
And I would
so
go—
So if I sue you, is right. that my problem?
Well, now it becomes the industry's issue because it's a well-known issue that they should be able to anticipate, right? I went to so many hotel conferences in the year that followed where they had all of these peephole protection devices on it, like a little piece of metal that hung over the peephole in the room.
Yeah, but I could unscrew that.
No,
I did it.
Right.
No, I did it on a Today Show. I was with Hoda and that guy from that new show that everybody loves. But anyway, he was the host because Kathy Lee was on vacation. Anyway, so we're going through a suite showing them how to inspect the room, how safety and security of a room, and they built me this hotel room door, and I unscrewed the peephole on national television. I said, you can do that in most brands. You can unscrew the peephole. So
wow.
I put it on national television on Today's Show. They get 100 million
right.
views, and you're still seeing, and Erin Andrews was on, you know, won a shitload of money, and it was on every news station in the world. And you still can, and there's one brand specifically that
yep.
I can go to the hallway and unscrew the peephole, and I can put a camera in and I can watch you undress.
Yeah, I would say then.
Did you hear me say that?
No, I didn't, but.
I said the brand, but I just mouthed the words.
I know, and I'm very bad at lip reading.
Okay.
But I was going to say something that was really clever, and now
no,
I totally
you weren't.
Forgot.
I can guarantee you were not about to see something clever.
So moving on, as a matter of fact, the woman's attorney said that hoteliers need to recognize the threat of digital voyeurism and they need to institute policies to protect their guests from such a heinous violation.
100%.
Good.
So now is that
point.
Now are you saying Hilton shouldn't be sued? Are you saying it's not Hilton's responsibility?
I'm saying it's the responsibility of the property owner and the individual, not necessarily the overarching companies, unless they've been shown, I guess, to what would be the legal term for it? Just completely,
malice?
Yeah, malice or ignoring it to such an extent. Now that this issue has come to light, then I do believe hoteliers need to start thinking about this particular issue. Technology is moving so fast into society that it's really... the technology is way ahead of where we're thinking. And you see this in a lot of times. And I think this ties back into the data breach story, and it ties into this. People are using technology in ways that were unexpected and unplanned
now,
for.
Now, I'm going to ask you a question. Does Hilton have a right to throw that owner of that hotel out of their system? Because
not only
of that?
A right, but I think that they should.
Right. Me too. They won't, because they'll be sued too for throwing them out. For some reason, somebody lawyer will find a reason why you can't throw them out.
Right.
So absolutely, I think that owner should be thrown out. because you have, now, again, it can happen anywhere, because listen, if you want to do bad things, you're going to do bad things, whether you're the best company in the world or not.
And that's the whole rub on any of this. It's something that can't really be prevented if somebody really wants to do it. If somebody wants to take a gun and kill people, they're going to do that.
And listen, we give master keys to people to go into somebody's room. And if that person's a really bad person, no matter what policies and procedures we have, that person may be able to do something, you know, horrific. Right. And so should the corporate office be responsible? And the answer is there's a team of people and a team of laws and contracts that will determine that.
Right. Yeah. And you know, it's one of those situations where I, for both these stories, I feel sorry for everybody.
I will say that woman deserves a shitload or a ton load of money because of that. And somebody should pay it.
I mean, that's just really,
it's horrific.
A really, really horrific thing when you have that expectation of privacy and something so odious happens.
And the person that did it should go to jail for a very long time.
Oh, agreed.
A very fucking long time.
So the last story that I want to talk to you about today, Anthony, is a lawsuit has been filed again against a major hotel company over an unnatural smell at this particular hotel's penthouse.
What's the brand? You're not allowed to say?
I can say because I just feel like we're beating up on this. It was the St. Regis Bell Harbor.
Okay. We are very fortunate to have these major brands because neither the ones would have jobs if we didn't have
right,
major brands.
That, yeah.
So we're not talking bad about the brands. We're just talking about
these
when you do business, this shit happens.
Instances and shit happens. And I think we're trying to make this clear. And that's why a part of me, in full honesty here, is I love all of these people at the brands. A lot of them are my friends. I want to... my natural inclination is to defend them and to look out for their best
interests. I can tell when you're talking
interests.
Because you're very you're hedging your bets sometimes.
Right.
And I understand that.
Right.
I don't really have bets to hedge because I don't really work for anybody but myself. With that said, I also sometimes do speaking engagements for the brands, and I also work with the brands and
right.
I consult with brands and all the time. So of course we want to protect our industry, and
right.
we always want to be respectful of our industry. With that said, this stuff is in the paper, this stuff is online, and we've got to talk about it and bring real, I think, real thought and real honesty to these questions.
And I'm glad you say that, because there is an element of us not discussing any of these stories ever that would make us dishonest in a way. So when we cover some of these stories, I struggle. Anthony doesn't struggle. I struggle some more, and then we talk about them. So meanwhile, at this particular hotel, in the hospitality industry, for a lot of luxury products, in order to make them financially viable from a development perspective, you've got to have a residential component. And that was the situation here. And this individual purchased a 2-bedroom penthouse at the resort for $2.5 million in 2013.
It's a lot of shekels.
And he's complained multiple times about a chemical stench and persistent odor, but was continuously shuffled along by management, engineers, and staff, all of whom denied any issue existed, the complaint said. So the filing maintained the smell was so strong that even when sleeping with the sliding glass doors open, he would wake up in the morning with eye irritation, burns, headaches, respiratory difficulty, and diminished cognitive capabilities. Sounds like me after a night at a hotel bar.
So what happened?
The lawsuit's going on right now. The general contractor recognized the odor instantaneously and explained the odor was the same exact odor that was remediated at many other units on the property several years back, the suit said. He was told the problematic scent stemmed from chemicals off-gassing from the vinyl substance used to muffle the sound of water running through the St. Regis's pipes.
So why didn't the general manager or the engineer just fix it and just say, okay, we have a problem? Or ask the old general manager from years ago, if there was another general manager, has this ever been a problem? It boggles my mind that a person spent $2.5 million and it got to this level. What the hell happened? What was the breakdown?
It's pretty crazy that something like that could even happen. Maybe they just thought he was a crackpot and it wasn't legitimate, but it sounds
proof
is otherwise.
Listen, I was just talking about this the other day. If you think somebody's not legitimate and they're a crackpot, figure it out anyway and solve the issue.
Yeah, that's
because
right.
It just gets out of your way and you can work on other things. So if somebody said to me they feel an odor, I'm never going to say, well, we don't smell an odor. I'm sorry, go, scratch. I'm going to get somebody in there to figure out what the problem is. Unless this guy's trying to play me, in which case, when you get an expert in and you try to solve the problem, they will say there is no odor, this, and this. Here's the report, full report. we tested the air, we did this, and now you know he's a crackpot, and now you sue him to get him out of your hotel. That's a different story.
Yeah. So I think what I'd love to hear from each and every one of you out there is...
Each and every one?
Each and every one, wow. All right? Even you, Mom. You know, I'd like to know what you guys think about these issues. Really,
your mom doesn't listen to
who
this.
Is culpable to all of these things? As a matter of fact, I think she does. Believe it or not, when we were recording last time, I said something about her, and I said her age was a couple of few years older than it actually was for a little bit.
And she straightened you out.
And she called me out. She's like, what are you kidding me? I'm only 75. I'm not in my late 70s. Stop saying that sort of stuff. So
anyway, your mom's always
so just let us know what you think.
At the end of the day, the hotel's making money. The brands are making money on fees.
Right.
The reason they're making money on fees is because everybody knows their brand and everybody knows the quality of their brand. Mm-hmm. So they're buying that brand. Mm-hmm. The owner, of course, has an obligation to keep you safe, but you're buying the brand. It is not your job to worry about the person that is running the hotel. It's your job to go and enjoy yourself and expect a safe and secure environment. So if a brand has their name on the building, of course, a court of law is going to say if they're guilty or not guilty. But with that said, I think the consumer has every right to hold that brand to a high expectation and a high standard because that's all they know.
Right. Yeah.
All they know.
Yeah.
I had no idea when I was a kid that McDonald's wasn't owned by McDonald's and by, you know,
McDonald. People still don't. There's a meme that's going around on Facebook right now talking about how much the CEO of the company makes compared to people that work.
That's a whole nother thing.
And that's one of those things that are kind of like one of those half-truth things for me. You know, I'd like to see people get paid a wage that works for them, but at the same time, they don't. The CEO of McDonald's has no say over how much someone an individual
But also, I have a strong opinion. I think everybody should be paid what they bring into the company. And the union housekeeper in New York City makes almost $40 an hour.
Right.
Okay, and people go, that's ridiculous. It's like, I mean, are you kidding me? They clean 18 rooms a day, 14 rooms, whatever they do. So they make $60,000, $70,000 a year. Mm-hmm. They should be making twice as much. Unfortunately, hotels can't afford to pay that.
Right.
But they deserve every penny that they can get and the union can get for them. With that said, I also think that an actor for a movie, if they're making $100 million or Floyd Mayweather making $350 million for a fight, they should get it because somebody's making money off of their back. Okay, so it's different levels. A housekeeper, $40 an hour, people think are crazy. Some people are making $8,000 an hour as a housekeeper, and they think that that's not fair. Some CEOs are making $200,000 a year, and some CEOs are making $100 million a year. It all depends the value your company thinks that you bring to the table. And I think that's why we live in the market that we live in the country we live in. It's because go get it, right? Go get it, right? I'm on the Travel Channel. I don't make as much money as the guy on Channel 4 who's making, you know, $1 million an episode. So God bless him.
Yeah.
Okay?
Right.
So I don't like when people bring those things up. It's like go get what you can get, and if you don't think you're getting enough money, then go get another job and go make more money. With that said, you should be treated fairly, and if the union needs to come in to make sure that you're being treated fairly, you know, then that is what it is. And I think this country, not to get in the hole. In one aspect, thank God for unions. In the other aspect, I think unions have put us in some situations that haven't always been good. But I couldn't imagine where this country would be without unions. So that's a whole different story. Because I've seen people, owners take advantage of people so badly in this industry. And unions come in and they do a good job. But with that said, I've seen owners do a great job and unions come in and destroy the culture of the organization because the owner was doing fine.
Right.
And people were happy.
Yeah.
So anyway, both sides. We're going to get in a lot of trouble.
We are definitely going to get into a lot of trouble.
I want to say something else, but I can't remember.
But one thing I would encourage each and every one of you to do is, hey, please give us a 5-star rating on iTunes and other places that you download these podcasts. Give us a great review, too. It really helps other people discover and find this show that are like-minded, just like you. And the best part is if you give us that 5-star review, we promise to read it on the air.
To get back to what we're just talking about, what we're talking about, should these big companies be held liable? And what I'm saying is you have the responsibility when you put your name on something to ensure that you are following through with your obligations. Now, translate that to you as an individual. when you give your word or you say you're going to do something and you're consistent, you will have success. When you try to blame somebody else for your problems because you forgot to do something, I always say to the general manager, Sunday night, 8 o'clock at night, somebody slips and falls in your hotel and I call you up and I say, what happened? You say, I don't know. I wasn't there. I will fire you on the spot.
Right.
It is your job to know. So find out what happened. Say the procedures you're going to put in place to fix that.
Right.
And of course, I know you weren't there and you didn't throw the water on the floor because you're home at 8 o'clock at night where you belong with your family. But don't tell me that I don't know. I wasn't there. You find out because it is your responsibility. 4 o'clock in the morning, something happens to your hotel. You're the general manager. It's 100% your responsibility. I'll fire your ass if you don't take that responsibility. That doesn't mean it was your fault, but it is your responsibility.
That's a beautiful way of putting it. So let's wrap up today. Anthony, tell me something I don't know about you.
You don't know that I was in Fort Lauderdale and I was with Cintas. I do some work with them sometimes and I love them very, very much. They're uniform people and they do many other things, but just a great bunch of people. And we were coming back from a restaurant and we got into a Uber. And I didn't know it was the karaoke Uber, whatever that is. All of a sudden, the driver handed a microphone to one of the guys in the car
and
said, hey, you're in the karaoke Uber. And we sang karaoke the whole way to our destination. And he had lights and he had a sound system and it was fun as hell. And this guy made himself a little niche. So when I go to Fort Lauderdale, I'm actually going to Google the karaoke Uber to find out how I get him again.
That's pretty awesome. Also sounds like a great TV show.
Amazing TV show.
Yeah.
Amazing TV show. So, but that's like doing a little bit different. And I guarantee you, he got a big tip.
Yeah.
So anyway, tell me something. I don't know.
I have too much unearned confidence today because I bought some shirts meant to be untucked and I'm feeling really good about that choice.
Are you wearing an untucked shirt?
I am.
Get up.
All right.
Hold on. I want to see an untucked. Is it truly untucked? That's their logo. Perfect. I love
great.
It. I love, like, I actually get my shirts altered when I'm on certain shows when I don't have to wear a suit.
Yeah.
And I'll get it altered in order to have it untucked and look good. And it's expensive. So I want to start wearing untucked shirts. I'm going to buy that company.
Yeah. You know, the thing
How much was that shirt?
I believe it was priced at $90, but there's coupons. You can always get 20, 25, 30% off.
All right. So a nice men's shirt. Yeah. That makes you look good is about $75, $80.
It's fair market.
Right, fair market. Value. And it looks beautiful untucked. And it looks very comfortable. Stand up again. I want to see something.
Yeah.
It looks perfect. Looks perfect.
Yeah, and I got to tell you, I had a speaking gig this week, and I was told to wear jeans, so I wore the jeans and the untucked shirt and a cool pair of sneakers. And
you felt like Heidi Klum.
I felt like a tech billionaire. But it was really great. I love it. It's much more comfortable look. Because honestly, for me, I have that issue of whenever I'm wearing traditional shirts, they start to come out, and you know, like the left side will be completely untucked, where the right side's not. And it looks
good on you, but can I give you one bit of advice?
Uh-oh.
First of all, if you're untucked and you want to be on our podcast as a sponsor, please call us. I'm going to give you one piece of advice and every man one piece of advice.
All right.
Please get magnetic stays.
Oh, yeah. You were telling me that off mic the other day.
You've got to get magnetic stays. Matter of fact, if I remember, I'll bring you a pair.
Yep, cool.
I'll get you a pair for Christmas or Hanukkah. Your collar looks good. But it's not tucked in all the way, and I need a tucked in collar.
Right.
And so tuck it in for me. Oh, you look so much sexier.
Yeah, I think, part of it is I've got a collar spread from being too comfortable here recording with you.
No, but if you put a magnet in there, it stays and it's beautiful, and then it's perfect, and it looks sharper.
I like that. Also, I'm finding the magic of starch again. I used to not have it, but if you get the right amount of starch in your shirts, the collar will pop, and you don't have to keep lifting it throughout the day. And when I'm doing stuff on stage, if I'm shooting video interviews, I gotta have that.
But the magnetic stays will keep that collar up.
Awesome. Perfect. And then I won't have to starch.
And do you iron?
Yes.
No, steam, baby. Steam saves the shirts. Stop ironing. Steam.
Really?
I have a steamer. If you said, Anthony, your cuticle oil, your magnet stays, and your steamer cannot get on the plane with you, I can't shoot a TV show.
Wow.
Because I have dry cuticles. I have major anxiety about my collar. and I don't like wrinkles. And my steamer, I can steam an entire suit within 30 seconds.
Wow.
Do not iron anything anymore. Please get a steamer.
Okay. I will leave here and I will get a I will get a steamer.
And don't buy it until you show me, because I've bought every single steamer in the world and there's only certain ones that work. The problem is when you're in the suitcase, once in a while they break and then you get there and you don't have a steamer. But I the steaming has changed my life, because I had so much anxiety about ironing my suits, and then all of a sudden I burn it, and then I just lost a very expensive suit, and I my favorite suit that I want to have on a show, and I can't have it. So steaming.
All right. Beautiful. I think that's a perfect way to wrap up the show. But Anthony, how can we find you?
You can find me at Anthony Hotels, anywhere you want to be on the internet.
Excellent. And I am at Traveling Glenn. And I want to thank each and every one of you for listening. Don't forget, give us that 5-star rating. Share it with your friends. Share it with your family. We love having you listen, and we'll be back next time. And thanks for checking in.
It's Checking In with Anthony and Glenn. Teaching you to be the hotelier that you wanna be. It's Checking In with